less stress, more time, more money. Welcome to the Cash Flow Contractor Interview.
Welcome to the Cash Flow Contractor, Sergio.
Thanks, guys. Thanks for having me here.
Yeah. We're all about, less stress, more time, more money. Excited to hear your story and just ask you a bunch of questions about how you've been on a journey of becoming a cash flow contractor, as Martin and I would say. Mm-hmm. Martin, I know you've been excited for this one for a while.
Yeah, I hate to admit it with him sitting right there, but Sergio's one of my favorite people, and that was a fire truck just went by.
Yes.
Could you prevent that, please? It happens, right?
Yeah.
No, Sergio's one of my favorite guys in a lot of ways, and I think it'll come out why I feel that way when we hear from him today.
Yeah.
So.
No, I'm excited to unpack it too, and just I think you came up with some really good questions, Martin, and you've got a really good story, Sergio. So maybe fill us in. Tell us, who are you? Where are you from? What do you do? What's your family like? What's your story, man?
I moved from Guadalajara, Mexico.
So that's a Spanish accent?
That's where the Spanish accent
is. I've always wondered.
That's where the exotic, you know?
No. Yeah. You know the difference between Spanish and Mexicano, right?
What?
I'm just kidding.
Oh. No, I didn't.
I didn't either, yeah. Yeah, well, I finished high school. You know, I was about 16 years old.
Wow.
And
like you graduated or you dropped out?
No, I graduated from high school.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Which is same thing in Mexico. Same thing as here. That's the step before college, right?
Right. Right.
So I wasn't sure about college in Mexico. You know, I was between communications and. And funny thing, I was thinking about marketing.
when I was
you know, younger. But then, because of the lack of resources, I come from a humble family. My mom, it was a single mom, as me and my brother, and I can really afford to pay for college at the time. I tried to apply for different scholarships, you know, but in Mexico it's a little different than here. There's not a lot of help.
Opportunities for financial aid.
Students, right? So my aunt, she lives in Chicago, and she told me, well, why don't you spend a year here with me, and I really want to learn English. That was my main thing. I was like, I was taking classes in Guadalajara, but of course it's different, you know. You got the door, you know, window, and you know, I was like, yeah, no. So she was like, why don't you take a year off, you know, take sabbatical year, just come here, make a little bit of money. You can work, she owns a cleaning company. And then you can work with me and all that and practice your English, you know, and learn English. And I was like, man, that sounds like a pretty good idea.
What year is this?
That was back to 2004, sorry. That was 2004. I was 17 years old.
So is that, I'm curious, is that something that's like pretty readily available in Mexico? Like were other kids your age in Guadalajara doing something like this? Or was it pretty unique, a unique opportunity for someone like you to be able to come here?
Actually, like in Mexico, the upper class, they do that a lot. Like,
okay.
People with a lot of money, they send their kids to
the U.S.
To learn English or sure. Even go to school. Now, school is cheaper in Mexico, but if you're in Mexico, it's hard. But if you go from, like, I know a lot of people to graduate from medical school and everything in Mexico.
Because they get their bachelor's here.
Yeah.
But then whenever they go to medical school, they go back to Mexico.
Exactly. But when you're trying to learn English, the rich people send their kids
here
to the United States to learn the language and the accent and everything. So it's pretty common on the upper class, but in the lower class, it was a unique opportunity for me.
So were your friends like, man,
you're
so lucky.
You're going to, you know, and then going out of the state is one thing, but going out of the country, it's cool. It was like.
Where did you say Guadalajara?
Guadalajara.
Okay.
In the Pacific.
Yeah.
It's this third biggest city in Mexico.
Is Mazatlán in Guadalajara?
Mazatlán is
south.
It's on the Pacific, on the Pacific coast.
Oh, you're on the Atlantic coast?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
But it was a really unique opportunity for me.
Yeah.
You know, for my background and my friends and everything, they were like, "Wow, that's cool." And I always feel like learning a second language, it would help me improve. I would have that idea because my dad was here in the United States, and he, every time I talked to him on the phone, he was like, man, you should learn English. That's a good tool to have, you know. And,
yeah.
And I always have that on the back of my head, you know. Yeah. So my aunt paid for my ticket and everything.
Wow.
Got my visa, my student visa. And I was like, well, let's try it. So I took a bus from Guadalajara, Mexico. I think it was like 30 38 hours. Yeah, to Chicago.
Yeah, see the U.S.
Yeah, but the whole experience, man, going from Guadalajara to going through the states and going through the border towns and getting to the United States, the culture, the differences, it was great, man. It was a great experience.
Do you feel like you had an accurate portrayal of what the U.S. was? Or did it like blow? You were like, this is so different than I thought it would be.
It was so different. I was like picturing something way different, like, yeah. You know, when we went through El Paso, because I came through El Paso, Texas, and it was like, man, this is really similar.
Yeah. You know, it was like, yeah, not a lot, and mostly Hispanic and Spanish.
Yeah. So the farther you go in, like, you
start changing,
and you, yeah. And when I get to Chicago, man, that's when the real impact, you know, the big buildings and. I have to the bus stop in downtown. That's where my aunt picked me up. You know, we went to see the Sears Tower, and it was amazing. And that was where I really feel like, man, I'm in America. You know,
yeah,
in
that's
United
cool.
States. But I feel like that was a great experience for a 17-year-old kid. Just do that, take on your own. You know. That's when I feel like you become an adult, and you become like, wow, this is it. I feel like every kid now, I mean, it's dangerous too. My mom is like,
right.
What I was thinking, you know? but I feel like it was great, man. It really makes me who I am right now. And so I got to Chicago, and then I spent just a couple of weeks in Chicago because I have to move to Indianapolis with my other aunt. Chicago was way too big for me. I didn't know how to drive. I didn't know how to, you know, I have a driver's license. So everything was hard. And then in Chicago, you don't really need a car. I mean, you guys know.
Yeah.
You can use this bus and everything. But I wasn't, I was really scared. So we went to a quinceañera, which is like a Sweet 16 mm-hmm. party in the Latino community. And I went to a quinceañera in Indiana, and Indiana is smaller. Indianapolis is smaller. It's more. It was a lot easier to get around in Indianapolis, and then I have a lot of family in Indianapolis, so I was able to work with my aunt on an apartment complex. I was doing. It was like a cleaning. I was doing cleaning apartments, like old apartments where people move mm-hmm. out. You know.
Yeah, make readies.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
and I was doing that for a little bit, and then. I went to a church. It was like a free ESL classes, yeah. You know.
English as a second language.
English
yeah.
as a second language, yeah. And I just fell in love with everything, you know, with the ability here that if you work hard, you know, you can accomplish whatever
dream.
You want. Yeah, American dream. So I was supposed to be here for a year, but then right before... I saved enough money to go back and buy my first car in Mexico, which it was my main goal, so I can go to college, you know. Because the campus from my house in Mexico is like 3 hours away.
Ooh,
so
wow.
The best way to do it was just having your own car.
Yeah.
That was the main purpose, saving money for a car and learn English. And if I was going for communications, English was going to be one. It was going to be a great tool for the career. Then something really... crazy happened. My mom make an application to become a U.S. resident when I was 3 years old, and my brother was 1 year old, and we applied through my uncle.
Right.
And that was just something that she did back when she was when we were kids, and my uncle told my mom, "Hey, let's apply for you guys, and maybe one day you get your green card." And my mom did it in a way that, like, well, I mean, let's just do it. Why not?
See what happens.
But she never was interested in leaving the U.S. She was always in Mexico. funny thing is, when I was about to go back to Mexico, a letter came in my aunt's house in Chicago, saying that my mom and my brother and I were approved to become a permanent resident. So that was a crazy decision, because I had to stay here, you know, to make the application process and everything, or just and get the money together, because it costs money to, you know, apply for everything, and it was like $4,000 for each.
Car money.
Yeah, exactly.
You put went towards your visa.
Wish you'd bought that car instead?
No. And so I decided to stay. I told my mom, hey, you know what? I feel like if I can get both, I can get the American citizenship and Mexican citizenship, then, you know, I can, it'd be a lot easier for me in life later on. I was 18 by then.
Wow.
And that's how it happened.
So you got your citizenship today? You're still green card?
Yeah, you get the green card first, and then, and that was the thing. As soon as I get the green card, I was like, well, let's go back. And no, you have to stay here for 4 years.
Wow.
And you know, then you can apply for your citizenship. So I was like, by the time I already had a job and everything, so I decided to stay, you know, and become a U.S. citizen.
That's great, man. Yeah. That's a really cool story. I love immigration stories. My father immigrated here, and I think immigrants are some of the best people in the world, because they have such a drive and such an ambition to accomplish things, and the American dream really lives through them. It's the founding fathers. It's the founding of America. So really cool to hear that story. And I know we're just scratching the surface. I know there's plenty of things that you're going to share today that are going to get deeper. So,
well, I don't want to be left out. You realize my ancestors immigrated too.
Yeah.
It's silly. Just about, I don't know, 12 generations ago or something. But anyway.
No, that's great. Okay, so what's your family like now? So is your mom here now, back in Mexico?
She's back and forth.
Back and forth.
She usually stays there for, you know, 6 months, but now since she meets a granddaughter, she's coming back. So she's back and forth. She spent 2-3 months here, go back, 6 months, go back. You know, she's just like.
So then your brother's here now.
Yes. Yeah. My brother came a year after I applied for myself. Then I applied for my brother.
Okay.
And then I had, you know, he came here, and and then my mom, and then he's actually becoming a U.S. citizen next year.
Oh, really?
Yeah, my brother. That's great.
Yeah.
So, well, we got to be at the ceremony, so make sure we know about it.
So Ricardo is his name, and he works with you.
Yeah, he's my partner.
I'm sure. I mean, man, we can really spend the whole episode going through your story of how you ended up in Oklahoma and all this stuff. But we got a lot of contractor stuff to talk about, right?
Right. Well, this is part of being a contractor, because there's a history that makes you willing to go out and be in business and take a chance.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And a lot of people aren't willing to do that. And that's one of the things I respect about business people in general and contractors in particular. Mm-hmm. And it's just telling us a little bit about that's who you are.
Yeah.
But Khalil's got a good point. What is your business?
Well, we do granite countertops.
Okay.
Well, countertops in general. We do granite, quartz, any natural stone surface. That's what we do. Remodel, new construction, commercial.
And when you say do them, you do everything? Your fabricators?
Yeah, we fabricate, install. We actually sell the stone, sinks, everything. I mean, we do from scratch. Because a lot of companies, they sell the material, others just install. We do the whole thing. We take the customers to the yard, select their stone, pick their own stone and everything. And I really fell in love with the industry. When I came to Oklahoma for the first time, my dad was already in Oklahoma.
So that's why you came that's from why I came Indiana to Oklahoma.
I was in Indiana, and then my dad, I didn't really grow with my dad, so I always have that in the back of my head, like, man, what'll be? So I talked to my dad one day, and I was like, hey, he's like, why you don't come here to Oklahoma and spend some time with me, you know?
Yeah.
And I'm like, well, why not, you know? So I really love Oklahoma, man. As soon as, because Chicago, Indiana was like overwhelming, and they're beautiful, man. Don't get me wrong. It's nice. But when I get to Oklahoma, I feel like I was back in home, you know? It was like really.
It's got a homey feel to it.
Yeah, like really laid back, and people were great, like so nice and so welcome. It was just cool. And he was working at the time at the company in Edmond, and he was a shop foreman.
Granite Company?
Granite Company, yeah. He was a shop foreman for that company. Well, it was a pretty big company.
Okay.
And he was like, do you want to learn the business? So I started working with him over there. And we were there for like 2 years, and he decides to open his own shop. You know, he's like, hey, you know how to do the measuring. Your brother know how to do the fabrication, because my brother was with me too.
Came with you.
And he's like, let's do our own thing, and that's how the first company started. Because we start one, and then he moved back to Mexico, and then I went back to work for another company, and when he came back, then we start
Alpha right now.
Yeah. Alpha now. Mm-hmm. And it's Alpha. It used to be Alpha Granite.
Yes.
But now you guys are Alpha Surfaces, and that's been for about a year now, right?
Yeah. Well, that was because just from a marketing perspective, a lot of people call me and ask me, do you guys, because quartz got really popular in the last 2 years.
Sure.
And since we're Alpha Granite, a lot of people call me and, hey, do you do quartz? Do you guys do soapstone? Do you guys porcelain. Do marble?
Yeah.
A lot of people think we just do granite. So when I talked to you, Khalil, and I was like, man, what do you think about that? And that makes sense. Now we're just Alpha Surfaces. And,
right.
And I mean, you know, I feel like
it's... Yeah, because you guys work with marble and quartzite.
Quartzite, soapstone.
Soapstone, yeah.
Quartz and everything, yeah.
So. Yeah, that's great.
Yeah.
So, man, there's a lot to unpack, but should we jump into your question?
I say we'll unpack it if it takes a little extra time, because I can sit and list this guy all day.
Okay. So
if that works for you.
Let's ask this. So, like, what's a typical day? Tell us about Alpha Surfaces. Tell us about what a typical day looks like for you right now.
Yeah, well, it kind of changed a little bit. Right now, I'm more focused on developing the business, sales. So basically, I get there in the morning and just make sure all the jobs, they're in line for the guys, fabrication part. I'm still doing a lot of the fabrication part, the production part. My brother is he used to do installs for us. But right now, we're trying to develop another guys and have my brother kind of do the office work so I can be more focused on sales and all that. So in the morning, I just spend 2-3 hours in the office trying to, you know, and then I go out and visit new customers and estimates. And I do my own estimates, my own appointments. I don't have any...
You know,
salespersons.
Kind of, that's what you're doing now. We will absolutely develop that. But when you were with your dad, you were working for your dad.
Yes.
For a
yeah.
while.
Yeah.
And at some point, he either began working for you or you just took it over. I mean, you and Ricardo own it now, and your dad's not a part of it, correct?
Yeah. Well, it was crazy. It was me and my dad started it. He started the second time, the first time and the second time. And he's like, at the second time, he was like, hey, guys, I want you guys to be part of it. Because the first time it was just him.
Right.
We worked for
right.
him. The second time, he was like, I want you guys to be part of the whole thing. So why just let's become partners, you know, 33.33%
right, agent right.
and all that. And he was in charge of the production. My brother was in charge of the installs, and I was in charge of sales. And templates
with your good English.
Yeah,
I mean seriously.
Yeah, yeah, it was. Yeah, it took me about a year to to develop and I just fell in love with the language. So I guess that's why I catch it really, because I know a lot of people they, it's like, man, it's hard. But to me, it was just
got it
right away. Yeah, I like it, and I'm still working on it. But so then my dad, he's just. He got tired, man. He just got tired. Granite, it's a heavy work. I mean, lifting those big islands and those big pieces of granite, it can get pretty heavy. Back then, we didn't have any machines or anything, so we were doing everything by hand. And boy, it's a lot.
Yeah.
So one day he was like, man, you guys are basically doing everything. I mean, I don't even know the customers. You, Sergio, are doing all the customers and templates and. Ricardo, you're doing the installs. And by the time we have a couple of good guys in the shop, they were like our pillars, you know? So he was like, I'm done. I think I'm just want to, you know, do other things, you know, something more settled.
Yeah. Retire.
Retire, yeah. So that was where the whole thing started going bad. We were making money, but we didn't really know how to manage the money. We didn't really know how to...
Did you know how much money you were making?
No, not really. Basically, we just work, and then I by Friday, I was like, oh, how much money we got? $10,000. Okay, $3,000 for you, $2,000 for me, $2,000 for you, and $1,000 into the savings account.
Yeah.
And that was our books. That was it. We don't have any software, no QuickBooks, nothing. It was just like that. So I was putting some money into the savings because we want to buy a saw, a bridge saw, to because we were back then we were cutting granite by hand, and he's like, let's buy a saw. So we start putting money into the savings account. So we bought the saw, and we put the down payment and everything. And when he told me that, he was like, man, I want to retire. So I was like, well, how much do you want? Like, we didn't even know how much the company worth or nothing. Like,
yeah,
it was crazy. I don't know how we survived, to be honest with you. And he was like, I don't know, 80,000. What do you think? You know, I was like, yeah, why not? You know?
Yeah.
So I went into the bank and just withdraw like $30,000. That was all of our savings, and just pay my debt. You know, just give it $30,000. And in the course of the like 2 months, I was giving him like, hey, here, Dad, I got $10,000 more. I got $20,000 more. I got until I paid off the $80,000.
Wow.
What I didn't realize is I was using money from my suppliers and using money from other jobs to pay my debt, you know? And that's where the whole problem, and I feel like that's where a lot of businesses, I mean, I feel like it's a lot of good business out there, carpenters, plumbers, electricians, and granny guys, when it comes to do the work, when it comes to do...
Exactly.
The, you know, but when it comes to the numbers and the business side, it's a whole different story, man. And yeah. So I start seeing it every week. Like, my brother asked me, like, hey, I need $2,000. Yeah, here, $2,000. You know, it was just like that. It was just like a cash... Cow, you know,
and
like,
you were the main one managing everything.
It was me doing the sale, the books, invoices, templates, everything. I was working from 6 o'clock to 10 o'clock, 11, like every day. I was doing invoices at home, and I didn't have any kids back then, so it was a lot easier.
Yeah.
And then I started feeling like, man, we start getting behind in a lot of things, like car payments and the rent, and we I never was behind on anything, you know. I always have like when I was getting low on my bank account, like getting low, like $500.
Yeah, scary low.
And then I was like, where's all the money? So I checked the invoices, and they're like, oh, well, that's it. I got $70,000 in invoices, like over 2 months. Like a lot, like people, I didn't even call people to pay me, like. So
and when you're talking about invoicing, I mean you hadn't invoiced customers.
Yeah,
not invoices to you.
No, yeah. I was already installed the job, everything.
And hadn't asked for
I just
payment.
Didn't ask for money.
Yeah.
Not even down payment or anything.
Wow.
So when I see my bank account $500, and then I see my suppliers coming, hey, you owe me $10,000, and hey, you owe me $15,000. I'm like, okay. So I go and then start calling the builders. Hey man, you have my check? Oh yeah, man, it's been in the mailbox for a month. You know? So I just go there, collect the checks, and paid everybody, and then back to normal. And that was my cycle.
And just kind of see what was left over after you did that.
Yeah.
Exactly. Surprise.
Yeah. So when I pay my dad, that's when I see a big hit on it, because it wasn't enough after I collect the checks. It wasn't enough to pay. And that was when I got that gut check. I was like, man, this is... At one point, I owe one of my suppliers like $60,000, and I didn't have any money coming in, and that's when you feel,
which you're now familiar is working capital was
not there anymore. And that's when I feel like we need help. This is not right, this is not good. And I knew we were good. We weren't stealing from anybody or using like money from anybody. It was just we were putting the money in the wrong places, like paying my dad or paying stuff cash, you know. We need a new truck. Well, I just buy a new truck and just pay cash of it. Stuff like that, you know. And that's when I told my brother, hey, man, I wasn't doing any sales whatsoever. Not at all. It was all word of mouth, which is good. That's how we grow. But at one point, you know, it wasn't enough because our expenses growth, our capacity growth, like we got more guys, we hired more people because we were getting more volume. But even then, it wasn't enough. I was bleeding cash everywhere, you know, from small things like tools and you know, overtime, a lot of things, you know, and materials. I was buying slabs left and right and wasn't doing inventory or taking account of the remnants, and have bodies that do granite to come into my shop and like, hey, I need a piece. Oh, yeah, just take it. Yeah,
oh, man.
It's free.
Yeah. Well, just curious, back then, I'm going to ask it kind of this way. What was your vision or plan for the future of the business? And then a second kind of way to say it is, when you're driving to work, you're driving around, or even on a Sunday, what are you thinking about back then?
Back then?
Yeah.
I wasn't thinking about the business at all. You know, mm-hmm. to me, it was just a way to make some cash.
Sure.
I'm being honest with you. I wasn't thinking about the business. And I don't think my brother wasn't thinking about the business either. We never really, like right now we have our meetings every week. Back then, we don't really sit down and like, hey, what's the vision? What's the plan? What's the future? The machine? How are you going to develop? Are we going to hire more people? Are we going to let people go? Nothing. It was like Friday, we close the doors and we just go and have fun and just go to the lake or whatever.
Wow.
We didn't have a vision. We didn't have a clue, man, to be honest with you.
I mean, that's perfect. And I think that's where a lot of people are, and maybe people listening that, you know, what am I doing? Mm-hmm. And if you don't know what you're doing and don't have something that you want, it's pretty hard to do it.
And the problem, I feel like a lot of what happened to me, thank God I find you guys before, because I feel like you can go from a very nice, comfy place to a very bad position, like owe money and not be able to pay and how I'm going to pay my bills. I mean, in like quick.
Right.
3 months.
One bad decision.
Exactly. So, and that's what kind of we were headed to it. Like, I was like, and everybody tell me like, oh man, you guys are great. You guys are wise. You know, we do great work. And everybody loves it.
Even then, even when everything was disorganized, all of your customers still liked your work. Builders still like working with you.
Yeah. We never had like a builder like, oh, we let you down and we wasn't able to install. We always fulfill our orders.
Yeah.
But sometimes I have to get cash from my own. And then I was going into my personal money and my brother as well. I mean, my brother one time, he pulled $25,000 out of his house, you know, to keep pumping money into
right.
the company. And that's when I feel like, no, this is not.
What are we doing?
Even a guy with no business sense can tell, like, this is not right.
You're
supposed to make money, not put
money. You were talking about college and people with business degrees. What you're just talking about is a business degree. That's how you learn. Because you go, hey, I'm not doing this anymore. What went wrong?
Yeah. And I feel like a lot of people, it's in the same spot. And then when they realize, if you don't do something fast, man, you can go into that bad spot like really quick.
Yeah.
Really quick, like losing your house and losing it fast. It's dangerous.
Yeah, so, that's a really good point.
So you were making money, right?
Yeah.
While this is all going on, how are you coming up with your margins? How are you bidding jobs? Was it just like, oh, that sounds like a good number? Or is there any methodology to it?
Well, my dad, and again, it's just, it's, he didn't know any better.
Sure, yeah.
He creates a method, but basically was like, okay, we'll see how much material we need. Not how much, like a full sheet, just how much we need for this particular job. Without taking account waste or anything,
right.
Just how much we need, and just add, you know, I forgot what it was, like, you know, not even a percentage. It was like add $20 per square foot on top of that, and you're good, and that's it. And that's how we come with the price. Like, it's not even, sometimes we actually lose, we pay people to do their job.
I think every contractor's done that. At some
point. No wonder the builders loved you.
Yeah. Hey, come on back. Yeah.
Goodness.
So whenever we get the bill, we're like, okay. And that's what a lot of contractors don't realize. You get a $5,000 check. And the problem is, you think those $5,000 belongs to you. That was her main problem.
That was we're a mistake,
like,
right there.
Ooh, we get $5,000. We get to spend $2,200, you know. And let's buy a truck. Let's buy. And it was things for the shop. I mean, like, oh, let's buy sinks. And that's when I realized, well, those $5,000, they're not all for you. Oh, first of all, you got to pay.
That is so well said. That's it right there. You think it's yours.
Yeah. And right now I know, like, okay, it's $5,000. This goes to the savings account. This goes back to the checking account. This goes for taxes. And you ended up with your profit.
Yeah. And to pay your suppliers.
Yeah.
I said at the beginning, and it's, you know, it's our mantra or whatever you want to call it for the podcast, but, you know, less stress, more time, more money. What was your stress level like?
Man.
Like, that's had to affect on your relationship with your brother. This had to have really, you know, what are all the things that are going on?
Oh, man. Even with my dad at the end, it was like when I was, after I pay him, I was just kind of blaming my dad. Like, hey, it's your fault. Why are we on this position? Because I pay you this much cash, you know? Mm. And it wasn't really his fault. I mean, he didn't know any better. I didn't know any better. And the stress level, it got really high, man. I lose my hair. Like, like, I was, no kidding, I had a full blow. You know, I lost everything. It was crazy, man. Because when you owe people money and you know, oh, money is not coming in, but you have work. That was a crazy combination. Like, we were super busy. But then you can buy slabs because you owe money. They don't sell to you. But you don't have money coming in. It's like a worse combination. You're busy, but you can't do nothing. You just got locked.
You're on credit lock, and they won't give you the slabs until you pay them for the last ones.
A terrible. Actually, it's from a movie called The Replacements. Yeah. And Keanu Reeves is in it. Anyways, it's kind of like quicksand.
Yeah, exactly.
Where
that's
you're stuck,
feeling.
And you, as the harder you try to get out, because you had terrible margins, because you didn't have, systems in place, because you were losing money all the time, and you owed so much money, all this debt, man, like, you just keep trying, it makes it worse.
It was hard, man.
You're losing money on jobs and you owe money, and you keep working harder, I mean, you're just digging yourself a further hole.
Well, it feels like we were working, it feels like we were working nonstop, digging one hole to patch another hole. And the good thing is we have money on our savings, me and my brother, and that kind of helped a little bit. But then, and my builders are great, like all my customers, I love them to death. But you can ask a lot of the builders, they might listen to this.
Yeah.
They'll be like, are you going through that? Like,
I have no idea.
You have no idea, because we always fulfill. We always have a... I told my brother, even if we have to go down to the floor, we're gonna come clean with our customers, man. And and if you ask me right now, how do you guys did it? I don't know. We were just like, okay, let me sell this and let me pull money from my account. Well, let me get some money from my equity house. But we always, like, when
scramble,
we finish the product,
scramble,
we're like,
scramble.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Can we get paid now?
With a smile.
Yeah, because we were needing that money bad.
So
a lot of builders, they might listen to this, be like, oh, Sergio, I didn't know you were going through that. Yeah, it was crazy, man. It was bad. And it put a lot of stress on me and my brother. At one point, we were like, man, let's just quit. You know, what's the point? I mean, we're working so hard and we're not making any progress. Well, we don't have any processes. We don't have any. And so how, and that's when, this is weird. And I don't want to sound really religious or anything, but.
Go ahead.
I believe in God, you know.
Yeah.
And at one point I was sitting in my desk, and it was one of those moments where, like, this is it, man. It was a lot of those moments where, like, you're like, this is it. And then something came out and we were able to make work. And I was feeling bad for my guys and you know, all that. I was like, but this is it, man. And I was sitting in my desk, and I went home. I told my wife, you know what? I think we're done. I think we won't be able to keep doing this. It's just too hard, you know.
Yeah.
I'm trying to push and push and push, and she's a really smart. I'm blessed, you know. That's true. Whenever they say you need a partner that it's smart and help you.
Yeah,
it's what you need. Because she told me, she was like, Sergio, you need help. You need help. You guys do a great work. You guys do a great quality. You guys been doing this for since you were like 18. You just need help. You need guidance.
Yeah.
And I was like, yeah, I don't know what to do. Well, I left the day before I left the shop early, right? Because I was feeling like overwhelmed and I just couldn't think. I was like, this is it. Right after I left, the day before, a guy from one of my suppliers, one of my big suppliers here in Oklahoma City, he came in right after I left and he dropped a pamphlet, you know, like a flyer.
Yeah.
And they were going to host a business coaching session with Mr. Martin Holy. Remember that? That
yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah. I remember that. Yeah.
But I wasn't there when he stopped by.
No, I said you weren't there.
No, I wasn't there. Yeah. But the guy came in and I wasn't in the office. So he just dropped the paper in my desk.
Yeah.
So next morning I came in and the first thing I find, it was that pamphlet, man.
Wow.
And says, it's business coach, you know, Martin, you know, Holland, Anil, you know. And I didn't call anybody else because I feel like that was a sign from God. I mean, this is just me, you know. This is just the way I feel. And I called Martin. And I was like, I remember I told you, hey, man, I need help. I think I'm not doing, you know. And that's when everything changed, man.
Yeah.
That's when everything changed. When you get your vision clear on the right path and you get everybody on board, and first of all, you got to convince yourself, because I was losing my grind. I was losing my hunger. I was like, this is it. I'm not good enough. I'm not good at this.
Well, that's the problem that I think people fall into, not just contractors, anyone in general. If there's a knowledge gap or an experience gap, and you run into obstacle after obstacle after obstacle, you start questioning yourself.
Yeah.
And that's not the problem. You were doing good work. Mm-hmm. All your customers were happy.
Yeah.
You guys were working very hard. You weren't sitting down and giving up. You were working hard. But there was a knowledge gap, an experience gap that kept you from actually performing to your potential. Yes. And it had nothing to do with who you were. It was more so you just didn't have the experience. And that's just an encouragement to anybody that's suffering any kind of difficulty, whether it's in your marriage or whether it's in, you know, your family, whatever.
Yeah.
There's usually just like an experience or a knowledge gap that, hey, like this can actually get better. It's not just about working harder. It's about working smarter as well.
So, oh, yeah, that's, yeah.
Yeah, and the thing, I frequently say it, I know you've heard me say it, the things outside, just keeping track of your business is as hard as doing your business. And I don't care what it is. I don't care if you're a brain surgeon or doing slabs or building skyscrapers. Keeping track of it is as hard as doing it. And in addition to that, you have to build a company and a culture and all that, and you also have to do sales and marketing. All of those things combined are way more difficult than doing what you do. I know you know this, but one of the things that people feel kind of bad that they don't know, and my first question is, why would you know? I mean, why the hell would you know anything about bookkeeping?
Yeah.
Why would you know anything about inbound marketing? Why would you? And to get that guilt off their backs that they're supposed to be able to self-sufficient, do everything, you're not going to be able to do everything. And if you're one of those rare people who actually has the skill set to do everything, you don't have the time, it's not the best use of your resources that you do everything. So that is something that I noticed right away is that you didn't come in here feeling guilty, like, well, I'm a failure because I don't know how to do marketing, or I'm a failure because I don't know about books. It's like, what do we need to know?
Yeah.
Because I don't know anything about granite. Mm. Well, I know more than I used to, but I couldn't do it.
Yeah.
Right? So.
Yeah, and that was the thing. When you told me those words, like, why would you know this? Like, this is, you know, and that kind of like, you're right, it gets that weight out of your shoulders.
Yeah,
like,
it's okay to not know, because why the hell would you know?
Yeah,
yeah. Definitely.
Exactly. Right.
Definitely, yeah. And I remember when you asked me about the books, so like, what's that? I mean, what your balance sheet is, like, I don't know what you're talking about. And I think that was our main problem, you know. And me and my brother, we tried to do everything ourselves. Everything, like invoices.
Let me ask you, why was that?
I feel like we inherited that from my dad. We just learned that the way he always trying to do everything on his own. He's always, like, I really admire him. He's been down in several times, and he's been up again. I mean, he's a really hard worker guy, and he always, I remember when we were growing up, he was telling me, like, hey, you just gotta do it yourself, or it's not gonna get done right. Do it yourself, it's not gonna get done right. That's like kind of like the Latino culture, you know, kind of like,
yeah.
And
let me just touch on that, because that's perfect. Yeah. But what's the problem with that?
Well, right,
do it
now,
yourself or it doesn't get done right. What's the problem with that?
Well, you limited yourself in a lot of things. Like, I was doing templates and invoices and sales, if you can
tell. I know what a template is, and maybe contractors know what templates are, but give us just an idea.
Well, I was doing, like, after you get a job, you bid the job, and then you just go and actually make a pattern out of plastic or cardboard or laser, you know, and you basically create the pattern of their kitchen, of the cabinets.
Gotcha.
And you take that into the shop, so that way they can cut it. They know where the wall is, where the edge is, where everything. So,
yeah.
And that takes a lot of time. That's time consuming. And so I was doing that and visiting new customers. And that's what I didn't invoice anybody, because I feel like it wasn't important. Mm. I mean, at the time. And my builders, I mean, my customers are great, because sometimes they actually call me. He's like, hey, Sergio, I owe you 3 houses. What's going on? Are you alive? I'm like, oh, yeah, yeah. I need to pay you, you know.
Because he doesn't want to sit there and have payables.
Exactly. He's like, now I understand.
Well, here's another thing, and I don't know. I know you well enough. This might not be true of you, but it's true of a lot of people. You don't invoice for another reason. Mm-hmm. And it's kind of like you don't think you're worth it. Now with Sergio, I don't know, but yeah. I see that a lot. And then it goes a month, and then it's 2 months. And now, well, I'm not going to invoice him because I'm 90 days out. But if you have that pride of workmanship and believe you deliver value, then heck yeah, you give them an invoice, because that's their opportunity to do what they do, which is pay you. Yep. So I don't know if that was always there, but I hear that a lot. Well, we just didn't think it was important. Sometimes there's more to it than that.
Yeah, and I feel like when you understand, they actually happy to pay you. When you do a good job, customers are ready to pay you. I mean, they're happy to pay you, you know, and you got to understand that. And one of the things that it really changed my mind was that, try to just delegate it, you know, I hire a new template guy. And every time I think, nobody's going to do the same work as I do. And a lot of contractors, I feel, because I wasn't the same way, we see like a new template guy or accounting as an expense.
Yep.
Oh, how much is going to cost me? Oh, no, 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 no. Oh, $500 a week? Ooh, no, man, it's too much. I can't do that. Let me do it myself. And we're thinking we're saving money. Hmm. It's a big trap, man. It's bad.
Okay, follow that out. You think you're saving money, but what?
But it's actually costing you
why?
Money, because the cost of opportunity.
What's that? Okay, yeah. Perfect. What do you mean by that?
Yeah, like now that I have a template guy, that I have an office manager, that I have, that my brother has, then I have more time to go out and sell and bring new customers and bring more value to our company.
Your time is better spent somewhere else.
Exactly, yeah. So I feel that's why the mindset from contractors are like, I can do everything myself. It's a trap. It's bad. It's a bad habit.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of people have that.
Well, and I think what you said there, they see it as an expense. They need to see it as an investment.
Investment, correct. Yeah.
Not an expense. Mm-hmm. And yes, there are going to be times where you have what you would call a bad investment.
Yeah.
An investment that doesn't return.
Yeah.
But you're going to have to live with that at times. Like, you're going to have to take those risks. And I mean, it's a 100% guarantee that if you try to do everything, you will fail.
Yeah.
If you're trying to grow, you know, if you're going to stay where you're at and just sit and do the same stuff
until your back goes out, and then you're going to quit anyway.
Until your back goes out, like your dad, right?
Yep.
Where he gets tired, he's like, okay, I'm done.
Yeah.
But if you're really trying to grow, if you're trying to, you know, build your company, build and grow as a team of employees, you have to see investment opportunities and stop trying to do everything yourself.
And I think a lot of the contractors, and this is what happened to us, and I think this is important because we didn't even know we were growing. And a lot of companies have this problem. We were growing because we were doing a good work. So we're getting more calls and more calls from other builders and from other customers. Hey, I hear you guys do good work and you do a job for me. So we were growing without knowing, you see what I mean? Like, we were growing without want to grow, you know? So we didn't really adapt. And I think that's when everything started falling apart.
Mm-hmm. Got too heavy a load.
You're supposed to be, oh my God, I'm growing. That's great. Let me hire more people. Well, let me do this. So we didn't adapt to that. And that's when...
I mean, it's kind of like the Notorious B.I.G. song, but more money, more problems. I mean, the bigger you are, the bigger your problems. Mm-hmm. And I think that's exactly right. When you're small, you don't see the big issue with not having the margins and all these different things, or not having the systems because you know everything and no one else has to do them. You're okay with just having word of mouth referrals. And you don't need to go and invest in ads or marketing or salespeople or anything like that. But as you get bigger, you can't do it all yourself. Yeah. And the problems it becomes a magnifying glass in all the problems you have.
Yeah. You know, in your day-to-day operations before, how did you keep track of your customers? How did you know what to do? Did you ever forget to bill? I mean, you've said you postponed. Did you ever realize that you forgot to bill somebody for a house?
Yeah. Oh yeah.
I mean, and how did you keep track of that stuff before?
It was all in my head. It was in my head. I had a little binder, a little folder with, I even got the chills, man, when I remember that, because it was just on the paper folder. And I got two paper folders. The jobs are being template and their jobs, they're already installed. That was my books. That was my system. That was my everything. That was my whole thing. Two folders. And one time I was driving and the folder flew away from my truck.
Oh,
there went your business.
Brayton Road. Yeah. So I parked and people were looking at me like, this guy's crazy. I was running.
Picking paper.
Because that was my invoice. That was my install.
Wow.
Folder, man. And I think I lost... That day, I think I lost one job. And then, man, that's what I'm saying. God is great, man. The builder called me like 3 months later. He said, man, I got this on my books, and I need to get out of it. It needs to be out of my...
Thank God. That one blew out of my pickup.
Well, because they... And I was like, ooh, that was one of the jobs that I knew. And I always have this... See, it's weird. I had a bad memory in a lot of things, but in my business, I always have good memory, like whose job, whose address, and everything. Yeah. And I knew it was like, this address is, do we charge? But then you're right. You're like, well, it's already 3 months. I don't know if I should call. Just ask. Hey, do we invoice for this house? That's it. It's all it takes. One call.
Yeah. And that's another perfect example of, you have all those doubts and should I call? And then I tell you from personal experience, a lot of people don't. And when I say personal, I mean I have not done it. Where all you have to do is call and say, do you owe us this? I mean, what's the risk or the fear in that? Yeah. It's just to get mindset. Just do it.
Yeah.
So.
Well, I know that we've talked a lot about how things were in the past, and a lot of things have changed, right? Especially in the last year.
Yeah.
The last year has been incredible for you guys.
Yes.
Before we go into how things are now, I want you to tell a story about what things are looking like in the market today and what's kind of entering the landscape with all these essentially competitors for you, but how that's changing things, and maybe give us an example of how you would have reacted in the past, not how you're reacting today to it, but what you would have done in the past.
Well, that's one of the things back in the day, like that was one of my systems, if you can call it that way, you know. It was like, if I go to a builder or a customer, like, hey, you know, they call me for a bid. I go there like, hey, this is the job. This is the quote. Oh, man, I got it for $1,000 less or $500 less. I was like, yeah, let's do it. And I was just trying to get the job.
Right, bidding to get the job.
You just get the job. That was, you know, I feel like the more busy we are, the more money we make. You know, that was my mindset.
Yep.
And So I didn't know any margins. I didn't know if I take $500, then I pay you to install your job. So I didn't know nothing like that. So I, that was my, that was the way I react to the market. Right now, man, it's a lot of new companies, a lot of new big companies. They're, we call it low ballers, and they're more focused on the volume. So, right. You know, with lower margins but bigger volume, they can survive. You know,
so far,
yeah. We more focus on I bet to quality, customer service, building relationships with our customers.
Yeah,
that's what we're betting to. You know, at the end, I feel like all those guys are just, they're coming, because I've seen it, they're come and go. And we've been in business for over, even with all that, we're going to be 11 years in business now,
That's great.
This coming months. And I feel like being honest, and that's how we react to that problem right now. Because there's a lot of companies right now that they offer you really low prices and really low, you know, but there's a lot of things, there's a lot of sketchy things behind. We don't like that, man. If I tell you this is a price, it won't be any hiding fees or any, I got a lot of calls, and I'm not trying to, you know, but I'm going next week to checking jobs that are like, they're not even back to finish the job. Like, they're left in pieces.
Like, other competitors went and did jobs, yeah, and they didn't finish them?
And I was like, how much you pay for it? You know, like, oh, you know, this much. And I was like, see, that's the thing, because what I tell everybody is something that I learned from Martin, is like, I have to charge you enough to take care of you, you know?
Yeah.
And I feel like when these companies, they charge you so little, and they realize, like, oh, we're not making any money, they just forget about you. They're like, yeah, screw you. You know, we're not going to go back. And I feel like that's where our edge is right now in the market. Yeah.
So let's talk about today. Like, sir, let's talk about the transformation and the path that you're on now. So you already gave us this, you know, you talked about your sign from God of Martin being on your desk and you calling him. I want to know from Martin's perspective, did you remember that call?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Okay. I mean, so, yeah, it was Sergio. Everybody remembers Sergio immediately. Yeah, so no, it was a lot of fun. They walked in, Sergio and Blanca, which is Sergio's sister-in-law, and Ricardo. And you did have books.
Yeah.
And I don't want to say what your sales are, but you're into seven figures. I mean, it's not like you're 5,000 a month or something. Yeah. And I just looked at it and I said, well, you know, if you'd have done this, your margins were this much better, you would have made this much more money. Sergio looks at me and goes, you're hired. Anyway, it turns out the books weren't necessarily right. And I think we need to, for people who listen to you, where you were, and then we'll get more into where we are. But how do you actually do that? And you already answered. I almost laughed when you said it. I've started some companies, and people look back and say, how did you do it? And I look at them, I go, I don't know. Yeah. You know, it's like day to day. I don't know, but we did. So I kind of laugh at that, but somebody wanting to do what identifies with everything you said, and there are a lot of people about the suffering, and to get where they're not suffering, and what you're going to hear, there's steps to take. And I think they'll want to hear a little bit more about that, but because it doesn't happen all at once. We've been working together 2 years,
yeah,
probably exactly right now.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
And the year before we met, I think you'd showing some losses on the books. Mm-hmm. And this month, or I mean, this so far this year, you're making a lot. I mean, in my opinion,
yeah,
you know, we always want to make more, but you're making a lot positive. And how does that happen? And so some of the things that you recall that we started with.
Yeah, well, main thing I think is getting, first of all, I feel like getting the right people on your side, it's key, building the right team. I feel that's great. One of the problems we had is we had an accountant that he was doing the books on a cash basis.
Mm.
And that's what a lot of the books showing, like, you know, wow, it's great. But when we get to Lori, which is she helped us with the books, and
she's a zeal accounting.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Exactly. She's great, man. She
let me throw something out for people listening. You said on the cash basis, that doesn't mean you're taking dollar bills. Cash basis bookkeeping is you don't record any. It's basically your bank statements.
Correct.
A sale doesn't show up unless it's a deposit, and an expense doesn't show up unless it's a check. What's missing there is if you have a whole bunch of accounts payable at your supplier, or you have a whole bunch of invoices from customers, those aren't even on your books. So Sergio wasn't talking about getting paid with cash, but cash basis books.
Exactly.
So thanks. Yeah, good. Yeah. But Sergio's sitting here 3 years ago. Did you know about cash basis books or accrual basis
no,
books or balance sheets or P&Ls? Yeah, anyway, so super.
And that's the thing. Our accountant didn't even ask us or you know, he didn't even, you know, I feel like a lot of the accountants, they just try to do like a cookie cutter. You know, one system works
it's for
taxes.
Everybody. They're just trying to pay taxes.
Yeah, and it doesn't work like that. So when we start working with Lori, she started working with Blanca. We we find out, oh man, we're actually on the red. You know, after she did everything, I call it her magic. You know, and she helped clean out her books and put everything into perspective. And now that you see, oh man, this is not good. You know. But that was the main thing.
So the books gave you information, a true picture of where you stood.
Yeah, that was a true.
And you never had that really, ever.
Never. I mean, I'm going to be honest with you. I opened it because a year before we started working with you, we got that QuickBooks, right?
Right.
And I was like, oh, this is cool. We got QuickBooks. because everybody says QuickBooks is good, right? I was like, yeah, let's get QuickBooks. And like, I was like, yeah, let's do it, you know? We open the QuickBooks and I see like a bunch of numbers. Like, okay, that shows that green, a lot of green. That means good, man, right? And like, I was like, yeah, it's gray, it's green. We didn't even know what that means. So, so first of all, it was getting our books and understanding your books. It's key. It's understanding. Yeah. It gives you a really big picture of what the business is doing. Where are you going with the business? Are you making money? Are you losing money? All that, man, it's on the books.
Well, another thing that you've got, I know, is everybody in business goes, man, I'd love to double my sales.
Yeah.
I mean, right?
Yeah,
that's what people think. Man, I want to double my sales. Well, your business and most businesses, if you do that without planning, you're toast. It's done right there.
Yeah.
Because of accounts receivable, inventory, increased labor costs, somebody doesn't pay you, more fuel, more truck. And if you don't plan for that, it can kill you.
Yeah.
It will kill you.
And that's what a lot of people feel like. They just trying to do, oh, let's just do sales and just sell like crazy. And let's just, I remember when I talked to Khalil, talked to you, and I told him, man, I want to do increase my sales. And you're like, whoa, are we ready for that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Seriously. Cause that's the thing, you know, as a marketing company, and we see it with some of our clients right now. If they're growing, if you're bringing too much business to them, one, you can never get a hold of them, which sucks being a marketer because you want to actually market who they are, not something they're not. Mm-hmm. And so you want to meet with someone frequently so that you're able to do the right things for them. But then the next thing is you start getting customer complaints because the contractor is not available. Well, now, whenever we're trying to put testimonials online or get Google reviews or whatever it is, we start seeing bad reviews. No one wants to give a testimonial. There's no raving reviews. We try to go take pictures of a job for somebody. No, you know, we actually don't want to do that. Why not? Well, it wasn't the greatest experience, whatever.
Trying to get a good product, but.
And so, you know, we don't want you guys to suffer your quality. You know, it's better to, rather than have that hockey stick right away, you know, you want to really progress into it. And eventually you can really start to, you know, increase the slope of that growth angle. But doing it too fast, there's a lot of issues that come with it.
Yeah. Yeah. Like you say, more money, more problems.
Everything. Yeah. Yeah.
And so I feel like getting the books, it was the first thing. That really changed a lot. That was the main thing. And then, understanding what we're doing, what we want to accomplish as a company. I didn't have any vision, man. Me and my brother, we don't have a vision. We didn't have a I think we lost our passion being so stressed about fighting.
Yeah.
We lost the passion. We forgot why we wake up in the morning, mm-hmm. why we do this, you know? And I feel like when you don't have that drive, everything is 10 times harder, you know? Well, let me rephrase that. It's still 10 times harder, but it's enjoyable. You know what I'm saying? You know, it's hard. It's
hard. There's a prize.
Yeah.
There's a prize for all the effort.
Yeah. And I feel like right now, me and my brother, we wake up in the morning and I feel that when I talk to him, when we sit on the meetings and Mondays and we strategize, like, okay, what are we going to do this week? We were doing a lot of things wrong. I remember when we decide, like, oh, we got to increase our capacity. I don't even know what we use that term because we didn't even know what that means. But I was like, oh, yeah, let's buy a machine. Let's increase our capacity. I guess he or I read it in a book or something, or in a quote on Facebook. Something like that.
That's right? Great.
Like, yeah, let's increase our capacity. So we, and you know, the people that sell you the equipment and all that, they want to make a sale.
They want to tell you to increase your capacity.
They're not going to tell you, oh, well, are you ready for it? You know?
So you had a crazy machine story, didn't you?
Yeah.
I mean, so how long, I remember, and this is just for small contractors who think that, oh, I need to increase my capacity, which is not a bad thing, but are you ready for it?
You have to do it on a planned basis.
Exactly.
And realize because what's going to happen.
You bought the machine. How long was it before you actually got the machine set up from the time that you bought it? How long was that?
Until you could use it.
Until you could actually use it. Like a year?
It was a year and a half.
A year
and a
half.
And what did the machine cost roughly?
About $120,000.
Okay. So just imagine that, $120,000. I mean, Sergio, you don't have to imagine it. But yeah. Just no, like that's a long time to pay $120,000 but not be able to use it.
Yeah.
There were multiple reasons, but really it was you had electrical that you had to figure out.
Yeah.
Pumping the water into the machine that you guys use.
Yeah. And that's where the whole planning.
Right.
It comes in place. You know, every decision, if I got to give an advice to, I mean, I'm not an expert.
Well, but you've experienced some stuff.
But if somebody asks me what's always planning, strategize, that's like the main thing. Because when we buy the machine, we don't even take an account like electrical. That was like $18,000. We didn't even know. I thought it would just buy the machine and you plug it in.
You'll plug it in 110 walls high. You
know, literally. I'm not kidding. That's what I thought. And just connect the hose of water to it because I know it needs water because it's a granted business, you know. No, man. I mean, I was getting into problems with the flow of the water, so I called the city.
You couldn't even dispose. Well, go ahead.
I called the city. They told me you got to increase your flow. So just call the guy told me, like, call the city and see if they can increase your flow by upgrading your piping. And I called the city and they're like, how much you need? I was like, I don't remember the number. It was like 4 inches or 5 inches or something like that. He was like, well, that's for like a belt, like a sky, you know,
skyscraper. Yeah. City office building.
Yeah, you don't need that much. If you want to do it, it's $30,000. And then I'm like, Jesus Christ.
And then you couldn't dispose of the water. You couldn't just let it go into the drain.
We need a recycle system that it was just...
One thing after another.
And you don't even know when you're thinking, we just solve our problem, which we thought, that was before you, Martin, we thought it was be able to produce. That wasn't the problem. That's when we buy the machine. So that's what I'm saying. If you don't know what your business is, what the problem is, then you do those mistakes.
Brilliant.
Like we buy the machine thinking this is the problem. It's going to solve the problem.
Production's the problem.
That creates a bigger problem, a huge problem. Because now we have another expense in a month, monthly basis.
Yeah.
And it's not producing, man. And it was every time I walk into the shop and I see the machine, I literally cry.
Beautiful. It's beautiful, it's brand new.
Yeah, it's like you're having a Lamborghini in your garage with no tires.
Yeah.
Because you can afford to buy the tires. Basically, that was it.
Yeah. Well, it's paying for itself now, but no, what a great example of lack of planning. And it sucked a little cash out, too. I mean, I know you're paying it, but monthly payments plus the down payment.
Yep.
Yeah,
money that we didn't even have. I mean, we were my brother has to pull money from he was building a house, I think. He was not building, he was remodeling a house. Right. And he got money to remodel his house. He has to live for a year on an 8x4 trailer.
Wow.
Because we have to use the money.
Money in the business.
So his wife went and lived with her parents and the kids. And my brother was living in a trailer wow. for a year and a half because we used the money to buy the machine. So it was just putting more stress on top of the stress on top of the everything.
Wow.
You feel like you're choking, man, at one point. And that's when I suggest to everybody that's listening, all your audiences, seek for help, man. It's people out there that they're more experienced than us in business. And if you guys know your craft, there's people with knowledge that can really help you and build a great team. Yeah.
So I wanna go and just follow a timeline a little bit before we move forward. You met with Martin. You guys discuss and your vision. You talk about your books. You get things. I know this is really fast paced, but you get things in your books organized. Mm-hmm. You figure out exactly what your margins are, mm-hmm. what your payables are, receivables, all these different things. What's the next step from there?
Then it was pricing. Be able to price things the right way, and make sure we make money. I mean, whenever you
let me ask you about this isn't a trick question, but what's the hardest thing about getting your pricing right? I mean, first you need to know what right pricing is, but what's the hardest thing?
I feel like you're taking account your production cost and like your waste and all that. A lot of people, like, I wasn't know how much it actually takes to produce that a kitchen, you know? So I feel like I can tell you, well, I want to make this much, but how much it costs to make it?
Mm-hmm.
That was the hardest part for me to figure it out. How much labor, how much hours, how much, you know,
yeah,
it takes to create a job.
I think for a lot of people, I mean, you may have were going to say this, Martin, but for a lot of people, it's getting over it psychologically. They don't think they're worth that much, or they think that nobody will take that price. Or that
yeah, that first customers. Time of asking what you need for a bid. I mean, you said it yourself. In the past, we priced to get the job and then found out if we made any money. But your philosophy has completely changed. We price for what we've got to have, and we can talk a little bit about how somebody listening can know what that is. And if they don't want it, tough. Well, how do you do that? You have to give them a reason other than price to buy from you, which is what you've done. You might talk a little bit about what your target market was before and what it is now, mm-hmm. if you feel comfortable talking about that.
Yeah, definitely, yeah. It was like, I feel like it needs to be a lot what you can offer. That's key. That's first thing. What makes you different and what makes you special, because everybody can, you know.
What we call a unique selling proposition. In other words, why should I buy from Sergio and Alpha and not all these other guys?
And I think that's key. I think like people need to figure it out. See, a lot of people want it one. And that's what that was me too. Well, I changed my mind. It's like what I can give first, you know, in terms of quality and customer service, and then, you know, then you figure out your margins. It's amazing because they really paint you a good picture of how much money and how much, and not just how much money you can make, it's how much you need, you know, to keep doing.
Yeah, need is break even, and then on top of that, you add something that you want to make.
Profit, yeah.
And how much do I have to sell to do that?
Yeah, and this is the thing, a lot of customers, they understand that. They understand you got to make money. I mean, that's
I got to make money to take care of you.
Exactly.
You know what you said.
And so that's what I feel we start working on okay, let's keep doing what we're doing on the quality. Let's keep doing the timing and make sure everybody's taking care of it. But now, one thing that I was really afraid is when we have to raise our prices. And I feel like a lot of contractors, they're trapped on that, man. it's a fear, man, to go and tell your customers, hey, man, you know what? I'm not charging you enough. It's just, I'm, you know.
So how did you do it? Because, I mean, I remember it well, but you're certainly doing it. How did you do that?
Well, basically, I talked to a lot of my, like, a lot of the people that I talk, I was just, I feel like being honest and being just really true. You know, I was like, sure. Hey, man, I think I was, everything went up. I didn't wasn't charging enough. I'm not making money. I think this is going to be the new pricing. I was working on my margins and I'm actually losing money here, man. And we have to increase it. And everybody understand it. Like I was afraid of lose customers and all that, but I don't think we lose any customers, man. Everybody was like, yeah. I mean, I think one customer told me, I was surprised that you didn't raise your prices in the last 4 years. Because everybody has to adjust to the market, right?
Yep.
And they were like, yeah, man, I mean, your quality is great. You guys keep doing the good work. Don't worry about it. Let's keep
going. I mean, I point out in passing, too, that Sergio's saying I'm going to raise prices. Guys go, okay. Mm-hmm. Some lowball junker comes in and says I got to raise prices, and they're not going to be as accommodating.
Yep.
Right. But I think at the same time, I think the beauty of contracting is that you're working with other contractors. You guys have the same issues.
Yeah.
You guys have the same. And that's not always true. You know, like if I'm a marketing agency, I'm working with a contractor, two different business models. But at the same time, with you guys understanding each other, there's a lot more acceptance to that. And I think the other thing that's important to take away from that is you didn't just send them the new invoice with the new pricing, you know, or put in the bid with the new pricing.
No.
You sat down, you had an individual conversation, and you were honest and upfront and transparent.
Yeah.
And I think that goes a long way with anyone, whether it's a contractor, homeowner, whoever.
And some of the customers, they were like, hey, man, I understand, but I can't, you know. And that's fine, too.
Yeah.
I
mean, that's fine. When you say, hasta luego, amigo, and then they come back later on.
Yeah, because they're in business, too, you know.
Yeah.
But then whenever you're in a better health, then you're – the way I feel like right now, we're working on trying to keep the cost as same down, you know, and that way we don't have to impact our customers on price, you know. And still adding quality, and that's been the key for us, man.
You know, I want to get to marketing, and we're
okay. Yeah, we're good.
I mean, I want to get there, but this is really important. Another thing that Sergio's done, if you want to get your margins up, margins officially being the difference between your price and then the cost of the materials and labor that went into it. So I got your overhead in there. Two ways to do it: raise the price, get your costs down. Mm-hmm. Well, a lot of people approach getting the cost down as being cheaper. Go to 2 cm instead of 3 cm. Use clear
silicone
instead of matte, and don't take time to get the seams right. And if you break something, just glue it. So that's one way. The other way is to get really efficient. Mm-hmm. And just not a trick question, but your margins, I won't say what your margins are right now, though I know, but 2.5 times what they were 2 years ago.
Yes.
Easily. Okay, I mean,
yeah, right? and we didn't really, and that's what one of the keys, we didn't really raise our prices like crazy.
Yeah,
we adjusted a little bit, man. Right. It wasn't like 15% or 20%. No, we were just adjust a little bit. Did the customer were like, well, okay, that's not bad, but then we really got really efficient.
Right, and that's what I wanted to bring up, because the efficiency side. The machine that we're talking about, mm-hmm. finally got hooked up, and that was a big deal. Yeah. And we don't have to say absolute numbers, but you are producing with 60% of the guys the same volume. Actually, you're getting better, more than you were with 100% of the guys a year ago. Mm-hmm. So your labor cost goes down. Sometimes you're leaving the bids the same, then your margins are getting bigger because you're getting so much better.
Well, something that you almost said, Sergio, that people don't understand is you don't have to increase your prices tremendously to increase your margins tremendously.
Right. Exactly.
Because you hit break even at a certain point.
Oh, yeah.
And any dollar above that is profit.
It's profit.
Oh. And I mean, we need, and Sergio gets this, Khalil gets this, I get this. This should be a topic for a podcast. But here's something I call the 1% rule. If you can get your gross profit margins up 1%, you will increase your net profit by 14.5%. That's not true for every company, but that is true for the average company, average contractor in the United States. So you get 1% better. And if you think, like when you're driving around under stress and overwhelmed, and you're thinking you got to do all these things, it's overwhelming and you want to quit. Mm-hmm. If you realize all I got to do is get 1% better, then you begin to ask yourself, how can I get 1% better? All of a sudden, you find ways to get 1% better. And you have, I don't know if you want to tell everything you've done, and you got another step coming up with the Northeast deal. Yep. You're just driving the cost out of your product.
Yep.
And by the way, you'll never finish doing that. You'll always get better.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it's like a lever. Everybody knows that term, leverage. So you got a lever with a big boulder, and it's working for you. If it's not working for you, it's slinging you off into space. We get it going your way, and everything that you're doing has been so fun to watch. Yeah. And like you said before we started here today, you're just, I don't know what you said, you're just thrilled, like just walking around.
Yep.
Thrilled.
Yep.
'Cause it's working, it's getting better, got more ideas. It's, you're taking care of people, the people who work for you, the people who are your customers.
Yep.
And it's kind of thrilling.
Yeah. And it feels great that, to be honest with you right now, after we've done everything, and that's not even taking, you know, the marketing side where we start getting better at that. Now I feel like after we fix everything, and then what I was really happy. I'm really happy that I take care of my customers, right? They didn't really see like a big impact on the price. They didn't really see like, because you can, a lot of, you know, you can just go, well, I'm going to charge this much, just random number, like 55 or 65. And they're, well, wow, that's a big increase. What are you offering for that price?
Yeah, what am I getting for that?
Yeah,
because
there's
price.
A market over there too. I mean,
sure,
you have a market where you need to compete. But I'm feeling so happy that I can offer the customers good quality right now. But at the end, I'm making money too.
Right.
Because you can either charging a lot and make your customers miserable by delivering a bad product, or that's the other way. You can make everybody happy, but then you're unhappy because you're not making money and you're stressed. Yep. That's not good either. Balance, man. And that's where we're at right now. Is like, man, my customers are taken care of. I can go back to a job site with no problem because, you know, they didn't feel a big impact on the price because I got my efficiency better. And I feel like that balance, it's great, man. That's a good point where we are right now.
Perfect.
With me and my brother.
Balance.
And then you can take it another level. Like, okay, Khalil, how do we do to increase a little? Now we know how much we can make. Can we make a little bit more? I mean, that was a key question when you asked me, how much can you make more? How many square foot more a week?
Yep.
And that was like,
there was
and
a different answer
now.
A year ago.
Yeah,
it's a lot different now.
Yeah, and I was like, oh, we can do this much a week. Okay, well, this is the strategy now we can place a strategy to bring more business in.
That's great. Well, let's talk just a little bit about some marketing things that I think are usually hiccups for contractors. I really want to focus on two specifically, but the first one is the branding. You guys were Alpha Granite before. Mm-hmm. You had kind of like a G pyramid logo that almost looked like an A as well. And you guys changed your branding, right? And so now you guys are Alpha Surfaces, but your logo also changed.
Yeah.
And it's kind of like remnants form an A. So tell me about, you know, what I hear from a lot of times with contractors is, we don't need a logo, we don't need to spend money on this, we don't need the design, you know, it's a logo, it doesn't matter. And maybe that's true. Right. But I just want to hear from your side. What has it been like? You know, I think it was a year ago that we did your logo. What has been, how did that impact you guys? You know, what do customers say about it? How do you guys feel about your brand? Those kinds of things.
No, thank you guys. I mean, really, that's amazing. Marlene, if you're listening, she did a great job on the logo.
Marlene,
she did a great job.
It is awesome logo.
Yeah.
Great. Well, the thing about it is now with the new logo, everything helps, man. It makes you feel more confident.
Yeah.
To show up and give it a business card, and I know a lot of companies, they don't care about image, and but then what kind of customers are targeting, right? Yep. And one, my brother told me one beautiful thing. He's like, man, we have the knowledge and the skills to do crazy job. And we've done some crazy jobs, man. They're like, a lot of fabricators are like, man, we don't want to do it. Yeah. And don't get me wrong, there's a few fabricators out there that they can do it. But my brother and my team, and we've been doing some crazy jobs. But I feel like it's hard to, you got to pair your branding with what you're capable to do.
Yeah.
Now,
excellent point.
A big problem is, I mean, yeah, you can do a good branding and you can have the best marketing company and then design a cool logo, but then you don't deliver it too. Or like what happened to us. We have this great quality, but we didn't have an identity.
Yeah.
The customer would be like, oh man. Like, I feel like a lot of my designers there, they told me like, hey man, your logo shows like freshness, like how do you say that?
Modern
in but classy at the same time.
Elegant, luxury.
Luxury, yeah. And I feel like that's what we do, man. I mean, we're not afraid of taking them crazy materials and
stuff. Well, I think because you're working on higher end projects.
Yeah.
But you're also working with, you know, on these higher end projects, a lot of designers.
Yeah.
And I think your logo really does speak to them a lot. I think I wouldn't be surprised if a lot of designers look at all of the different countertop contractors out there.
Yeah, look like you did it in a Word document.
And then they see Alpha and they're like, oh, that one really sticks out.
Oh, yeah.
So that's really good.
Yeah.
So that's one thing, you know, I always tell people when you're walking through Walmart or you're walking through the grocery store and you're going to buy, you know, let's say Oreos, for example. Are you going to buy the great value Oreos? Or are you going to buy the Oreos?
Yeah.
And I mean, it's basically just that. Whenever a customer looks at a brand, it's the first impression. It's, you know, don't judge a book by its cover. Well, Martin's writing a book right now. I bet he can tell you a lot of people judge the book by its cover.
Yeah.
And that if that's going to be the entrance and the introduction to your company and to working with you, then it's got to be something that's really presentable, that speaks to them and communicates the values that you have as a company. So not the typical topic for marketing with a contractor, but that is a very important one that I want to touch on because I think you guys made the right choice and I think you guys came out with a really great product with that. So the next one that I want to talk about is really the sales process. Going back to the story that you talked about earlier, you had mentioned or what it was like for you, you know, 2 years ago. Sales was, you had two binders. You had one that was installs and one that you're doing templates for. Mm-hmm. And it flies out the window. Other than that, it's in your head too, right? And
it's on the cloud, and it's also in hard data.
it's on your personal cloud.
Yeah. And it's also your brain. My personal cloud.
But as soon as you guys started using the CRM, you started using HubSpot. You've got all your contacts in there, but all the deals. How did that transform? Tell us a little bit about what is HubSpot to you? How do you use it? And how has it made a difference for you?
Yeah, the CRM, the customer relationship management software. Man, I don't know how to explain it. It's day or night. It's crazy. It is. First of all, it helps with your customer if they need information on the job. Before, this is what I really like about it. Before they need to, everybody needs to call Sergio. Everybody needs to call me. Where the job, like where we're doing with the job, where we at on the job. Right now, if customer called and asked Blanca, she's the office manager, hey, where my job is, and she can just go into the HubSpot and be like, it's in fabrication right now. It's in the fabrication stage. It's on the templating stage. Oh, we have you on schedule. It's appointment schedule for, you know, it's ready for install. And it's those stages where customers, you keep your customer informed. Before it was like, it happens that I call my customer like, hey, we're here to install right now. Like I'm in the bathroom. I'm like, I don't even have anything ready. What, you know, we basically show up, you know, and now we are more with HubSpot. The software really helped us to manage our production. And then another cool thing about it is it show you how much money you have on each stage.
right.
tie it up, you know.
Like, so you've got basically all these deal stages. So yeah. you take a deal, you take it through from the beginning of like initial appointment to mm-hmm. figure out what's going on with the job, all the way through till we've collected the money.
Yeah, close right? the contract.
Yeah. yeah, and so you're saying that basically the deal, whenever it's in that stage, so say you have 10 deals, 10 different jobs that are in materials ordered. You can look at the bottom of that column and it tells you exactly how much all those jobs add up to. So now you've got those 10 jobs, you've got $100,000 tied up in materials ordered.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. And then you can continue to move it along and know exactly where your money's tied up and what it's going to take to get it to the closed one where it's in your bank account.
Yeah, yeah. That's one of the, I will say, one of the key ingredients for us right now. It's that customer relationship management software, HubSpot. Yeah. It's key. And I don't know if there's, to me, that's the only one. It's HubSpot, but I know it's all there. But having a software on your side to help you manage your customer, your sales, and everything, man, it's huge.
Yeah.
And I'm going to be honest with you. At the beginning, it was overwhelming. It kind of see.
Yep.
But it gets easier with time, and everything was overwhelming.
You just had to learn how yeah. to do one process, yeah. and you know.
Yeah. 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 And so that yeah, that's great. It's been yeah. really it's key.
Well, there's always resistance to change, and yeah. it's until you make something a habit that you really start to see the difference. You yeah. know, it's just like it's hard to go and tell all of your customers that you got to increase your prices. Mm-hmm. Eventually, when you increase it, you're going to be really glad that you did.
Yeah.
You know, you're not going to sit there and increase all your prices, and if all your customers are there, still be like, man, I wish I wouldn't have done that. Mm-hmm. No, like, you're thankful that you increased your prices. You have a bigger margin now. You feel less stress. You have more money. You've got more time. You can go and hire more people, all those different things. You can actually grow. Same thing with the deals inside of HubSpot or a customer relationship manager. I mean, just knowing, I mean, for you guys, it's just so easy to see, hey, here's our invoices. You yeah. don't have to log into your QuickBooks. You can pull it up on your phone in a second and flick through and tell me every single person yeah. right now that owes you money on a job or that's being installed tomorrow. So really cool. So those are just a couple of things. I mean, there's a lot more that we could talk about, but I want to move on to our Mount Rushmore segment. I think this has been a great episode, but really at this point, Martin and I, for our Mount Rushmore segment, I guess I need to give some noise here. Let's see if this works. I don't know if it will. Let's see if we can do it.
There you go.
Okay. We'll see if that was good enough. And I don't even know if that's the right one. We'll get it. So we're doing the biggest improvements. What had the biggest impact? So we're choosing four things that we think that Sergio did, that Alpha Surfaces did, that had the biggest impact. We could say, you know, increased prices. We could say, you know, efficiencies in the shop.
You are saying?
No, I'm not saying. we could say the marketing was yeah. incredible. We could say, you know, Martin Holland transformed the company single-handedly.
Yeah, yeah. No, he sure did.
Anyways, we're going to choose four things. And then, Sergio, you're going to give the best one that Martin had, the best one that I had, and then the best one overall.
Overall, yeah. Okay.
So the George Washington.
Okay, well, this changed because I thought about this beforehand, but this occurred to me. And again, I hate to be nice to...
So you're going through your four right now.
I'm going through my four. I'm going... I hate to be nice to Sergio when he's sitting right there, but one thing that occurs to me is that everything you've done required courage. And the courage to seek help, the courage to pay me money, which is significant, when you didn't have any, the courage to raise your prices, the courage to hire Khalil and Benelli Marketing before they had, I mean, it's a faith, but it's also a courage in it. So I'm gonna put that as number one. Another number one is books. And that took that's another thing you did. You hired Lori, which was not cheap, to get your books right without really even knowing, I know I need something. I don't really know why this is so important. But so courage, books, a vision for your company. If you didn't have a vision for your company, you wouldn't be doing any of this. I mean, it partly provided the courage, or I think as well. And then, I don't know if I'm getting them all, but the other one is the efficiency. We didn't dive into it a lot, but what you've done out in the shop and your templating with hard things like machines and cranes, and also soft things like scheduling, so that you're not kicking out a job half finished and doing another one, all those things. So that's what it is. It's courage, it's vision, or books, vision, and operational efficiency.
Okay. Nice.
We're not done on any of them.
There's some overlap, but I'll try to switch it up so it's not too easy. So you gave courage. I was going to say delegation, which I guess you could...
Takes courage to delegate.
Takes courage to 100%. Delegate. But you delegated the things that were better suited for you not to occupy your time with. Like, you know, you delegated the responsibility of knowing everything to Martin, right? Not that he knows everything, but he knew more. He had more experience. Delegated marketing to us, delegated to Lori, all those different things. Even inside your business.
Ricardo, you delegated
to Ricardo. You delegated to Blanca. You delegated to... To Alan, all these different people, right?
Yep.
So I think that delegation was huge on there. The next thing that I'm going to say is the price increase. It goes with margins, all that stuff. But I think that the fact that you increased your prices was huge. Mm-hmm. And I wish that people would do more of it, because I see so many people, like right now with COVID, people, residential contractors are actually doing really well.
Yeah.
And there are contractors that are stressed out and they've got so much demand and they're trying to fill it, but they're not really changing anything. Yeah, they hired a new guy. But if they would just increase their prices, a lot of their stress would go away. So I think increasing the prices was huge. The next one I'm going to say is books. I know, Martin, you said books, but I think having that in order and just having financial clarity is massive. And then the last one that I'm going to say is... it kind of goes with courage, but just, I think, grit. Mm-hmm. I think the fact that you didn't give up, like you told us your breaking point. Every time I see you, you're always passionately working on something. And I think that not only requires vision and support and hope and goals and all these different things, but you have a true grit to you. And, a lot of people would have folded in your situation, and you really pushed through it. So those are my four, right?
Excellent.
What
if you remember what they were?
The George Washington, man. The one from Martin, it's I think the vision, man. Yeah. I think vision, it's key for every business. It's I don't think any business is born without a vision. Like, that's the first thing, is your vision, then you make it happen, right? I think vision is, I didn't have that. You know, I didn't have that really. It was like just going
to work.
Yeah, just doing whatever. You know, now I'm doing things right now that it's going to impact in the next 4 or 5 years. So that vision forward, I think it's amazing. And man, great. You know, that not give up. That's really. Whew, that's what it really keeps me and my brother. First of all, not killing each other. Like, that was like, you know.
Oh, man.
Well, one
man,
point.
If I was your brother and you made me live in a trailer, with my wife and kids at my third parent.
Yeah.
Oh, man. I can't.
That guy.
He's got to have a lot of humility for that, too.
So yeah, that guy, he's just, he's my guy. I mean, I don't think we can work without him or him without me. We're like a one.
Yeah.
But I think that not giving up, I mean, books and everything, I think at the end it makes it happen, right? But
it's a result of.
Exactly, the result of not giving up and having a good vision, man. That's my George Washington.
Okay.
Man, I gotta go with vision, man.
Vision.
Vision.
Martin wins this one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, you know, anybody listening, but every client I ever have, I ask them, first time we meet, I mean, maybe after the chit chat, is what do you want? Yeah. And the vast majority always ask me, well, what do you mean?
Yeah.
I said, I mean, what do you want? How are we supposed to go get it if you don't know?
Man, when you give me that.
Sometimes it's hard.
You give me the task, both of you guys, you ask me, okay, what's the vision of the company? That was the hardest thing, man.
I know, you wrote it out in Spanish.
Yeah, and, I have to do it in Spanish because I. That was one of the most important statements in my life. Like, My kids depend on my business, man. And when you ask me that question, I feel naked. I go like, I don't know. Oh, what? And I ask you guys, remember I asked you guys, what's vision, man? What do you mean with the vision? And you guys trying to explain. I mean, you explain it your way, and you give me that the younger, fresh perspective, and you give me that wise, you know, and that both things help. But I had to do it. I remember I doing it in Spanish, yeah, and we translated.
Yeah.
So I think that's my George Washington, man. Thank you guys.
Well, I'm not going to put you on the spot and say, tell everybody what your vision is.
But. Yeah.
Well, we've got our next segment now, which is quote of the day. Hold on, let's see if we got the music. Okay. The music for this. Let's see here.
Let's see what he got on that.
That's it.
There you go. That was it. Okay, and this is from Sergio.
Yeah, from Sergio. Hit us with your. And let's hear it in Spanish and tell the story behind it too.
It's a veces se gana y a veces se aprende. So sometimes you win, and sometimes you learn. And this is weird because I got that from my 5-year-old daughter. I was raising her in the Texas Roadhouse parking lot, and I let her win. You know, we raced to our car, and she beat me. You know, I let her win, and she touched the car first. Whoever touched the car first win, and I let her, you know, she touched the car, and I was like, oh, man, I lose. And she was like, no, Daddy, sometimes you win, sometimes you learn. You got to go faster next time.
That's the win, and that's so true, man. That's perfect.
And that's kind of like my business, man. We learn so much by being down.
Yeah.
It's great, man.
Well, you know, we've really appreciated you having you on. But before we go, we do have our intern insights. Mm-hmm. Shout out to Ethan. By the way, this is the first episode that we've done where we are all in one room. Uh-huh. Usually we're all remote, but we're all in one room. I'm not sure how the audio's turned out on this episode, but...
Well, it better be good. Well, it's going to go get published even if it isn't.
Oh, absolutely.
It's too good.
But, Ethan's going to use my mic for the first time, so let's get him all set up. As you guys know, we're going for a minute for his intern inside
a lot of stuff.
Oh, Siri. You ready for this, Ethan?
Not sure. We got a lot of stuff for a minute.
Yeah, there's a lot. We'll give you 90 seconds today.
90 okay. seconds.
90 okay. seconds. I'm going to start the clock. 1 second. All right. Let's get your music going for Intern Insights.
Ooh, I like that one.
We got cool music. Yeah.
You got the cool one.
Let's go, Ethan. Go for it.
Okay. So I'm going to start with my main points. So be efficient. Have a vision. Plan everything. Seek help. Don't avoid it. And know the quality of your work. Now I'm going to start back. So things go from comfortable to worse very quickly. It's just like right when you think you're okay, boom, it all falls out. Alpha used to do everything on their own, which led to no sales, books, no planning, plus no vision. Right when their things were as bad as it could be, he met Martin. Build a solid team around you. Understand your books is key. And be ready to increase your capacity. Don't do it too soon. Know the quality of your product and service. What makes you different? What makes your product special? Customers understand that price is high for a reason, so deliver high quality and you'll get paid. Moving on to marketing. CRM is one of the most key ingredients to our process. We can manage customers, sales, and processes all in one place. And a new logo has brought new confidence. They were able to work with higher end people and deliver higher products and make more profit. And a couple quotes. When you do a good job, customers are ready to pay you. It's not always about working harder, but working smarter. And busy doesn't always mean more money. And the last one, mo money, mo problems.
Good job,
great,
man. Okay. Thanks, guys.
That was half the stuff.
That was great.
Oh, really?
Wow. Well, you did under 90, so that's good.
Recap. Are we off?
We are not off, but we can be off. You want to be off?
No. Can you get out of here, Warren? No.
Okay. Well, hey, thank you again, Sergio. Thanks for sharing your story. I know a lot of people are going to be inspired by that, and that hopefully they will become cash flow contractors that have less stress, more time, more money. We'll see you guys next time.
We'll put his website and his cell phone in the notes.
Look so in you can the get notes calls if you want to get long. In contact with Sergio, alphaokc.com.
Yes.
We'll put his email in there. Check him out online. They've got all the social media channels. See you guys soon.
Thanks, guys. Appreciate it.
Thanks for listening to The Cashflow Contractor. Check out our website in the show notes or visit thecashflowcontractor.com.
What's up, Cashflow Contractors? Khalil here. Thank you so much for getting to the end of this episode. It means the world to us that you're listening. I've got a favor to ask. So we are looking for contractors who would like to have a consult, a free consult with myself and with Martin for about 30 minutes to an hour. We'll basically just ask you questions about your business, about what it's like for you to work as a contractor, and then we will answer any of your questions specific to your business. Then we'll make that a live episode for other contractors to learn from, to engage with. And we think it's a great way for people to really see clear, specific answers to problems that contractors have. So if that interests you at all, we're not gonna share any of your information. You don't even need to say your name on the episode, but I think we wanna get some more of these episodes out there. And if you're willing to do that, we've got a link in the show notes that allows you to just submit a form for a consult, then we'll schedule it with you and record it, and we'll put you live on the podcast. So if that interests you, please check it out in the show notes. If not, no worries. Or if you know someone else that you think would be interested in it, send it to them. That'd be great. But appreciate it. Thank you so much for joining us. And yeah, we hope that you're finding less stress, more time, and more money. Thanks.